My name is Napoleon McClinton, and thank you for joining us for our Sunday School lesson study for today. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Father in heaven, we come today to thank you for another day that you have made. We thank you, Father, for watching over us throughout last night as we slumbered and as we slept. We thank you for waking us up this morning and for giving us a mind and a heart to praise and to glorify you as we study your holy word. We pray now, Father, that you would help us to set aside any cares and concerns that we might have, that we may look deeply and intently into your word, and that we may find practical applications for our daily lives. We thank you, Father, for this church, the Greater Shiloh Missionary Baptist Church. We thank you, Father, for all our leaders and for this congregation at large. We pray, Father, that you will continue to bless us and to keep us safe in your care. Help us to be the kind of church, Father, that would be Christ-oriented, that others would come to know you through your darling Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for this community and for this neighborhood and for this city and for this county and for this state and nation that we live in. We pray, Father, that you would continue to bless our political leaders. Help them to be guided, Father, by you, knowing, Father, beyond the shadow of a doubt, that you are in control. And no matter how the circumstances may be, Father, all power in heaven and in earth is in your hands. We pray now, Father, that you would bless our study today. We thank you for your darling Son, Jesus. And we pray also, Father, for those that are sick, for those that are shut in, for those that are suffering from the loss of some loved one. We pray, Father, for those that are struggling and downtrodden and confused and lack understanding concerning the issues surrounding this global pandemic, as well as this economic shutdown. We pray, Father, that all those that are able and willing will get the vaccination, and Father, that our nation and our lives will be restored to normal. We thank you for your darling Son, Jesus Christ, who because of his death, his burial, and his resurrection, and our faith in him, Father, we too can have life, and we can have it more abundantly. In Jesus' precious name we pray, amen. Again, welcome to our study. Our lesson study for today is the April 11th lesson, and it's lesson 6, and it's entitled Faith in Action Preacher, as we study from the book of Ezra, beginning at chapter 10, verses 1 through 12. We continue in our Unit 2 of series of lessons, which has to do with prophets of restoration. And so as you look on the screen, you'll see our agenda for today. The lesson is lesson 6. It's entitled Faith in Action Preacher, from Ezra chapter 10, verses 1 through 12, and the New International Version of the Bible. The first outline is conviction of sin from Ezra chapter 10, verses 1 through 4. Our second outline is covenant and courage from Ezra chapter 10, verses 5 through 8. And our third outline is call to action from Ezra chapter 10, verses 9 through 12. And so let's read our lesson scripture, which is also on the screen. And our scripture is really entitled The People's Confession of Sin from Ezra chapter 10, verse 1 through 12 from the New International Version of the Bible. We find these words beginning in verse 1. While Ezra was praying and confessing, weeping and throwing himself down before the house of God, a large crowd of Israelites, men, women, and children, gathered around him. They too wept bitterly. Then Shechaniah, son of Jehiel, one of the descendants of Elam, said to Ezra, "We have been unfaithful to our God by marrying foreign women from the peoples around us. But in spite of this, there is still hope for Israel. Now let us make a covenant before our God to send away all these women and children. in accordance with the counsel of my Lord and of those who fear the commands of our God. Let it be done according to the law. Rise up. This matter is in your hands. We will support you, so take courage and do it. So Ezra rose up and put the leading priests and Levites and all Israel under oath to do what had been suggested, and they took the oath. Then Ezra withdrew from before the house of the Lord and went to the room of Johanan, son of Eliashib. While he was there, he ate no food and drank no water because he continued to mourn over the unfaithfulness of the exile. A proclamation was then issued throughout Judah and Jerusalem for all the exiles to assemble in Jerusalem. Anyone who failed to appear within 3 days would forfeit all his property in accordance with the decision of the officials and the elders, and would himself be expelled from the assembly of the exile. Within 3 days, all the men of Judah and Benjamin had gathered in Jerusalem. And on the 20th day of the 9th month, all the people were sitting in the square before the house of God, greatly distressed by the occasion and because of the rain. Then Ezra, the priest, stood up and said to them, "You have been unfaithful. You have married foreign women, adding to Israel's guilt. Now honor the Lord, the God of your ancestors, and do his will. Separate yourselves from the peoples around you and from your foreign wives." The whole assembly responded with a loud voice, "You are right. We must do as you say." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God. And so our next discussion item will be our lesson context, which is also on the screen. Again, this is for the April 11th, Lesson 6 lesson, and it's entitled "The Faith in Action Preacher" from Ezra chapter 10, verses 1 through 12 of the New International Version of the Bible. And we've been studying from Unit 2 for this month of April, and the unit is entitled Prophets of Restoration. And so let's read our context together. There are times in relationships with God when people essentially lock themselves up and put their lives on the line. Yet when solutions are offered for real problems, people have a choice to listen to their guide or go it alone. Will the solution be applied or not? Under the leadership of King Nebuchadnezzar, the Babylonian Empire overtook Jerusalem and exiled the people of Judah, the southern kingdom, in 586 BC. Eventually, the Persian king Cyrus defeated Babylon. Cyrus released the Jewish exiles led by Zerubbabel to return home to Jerusalem in 538 BC for the express purpose of rebuilding the temple. From Ezra chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. Following that first wave of returning exiles in 538 BC was a second wave led by Ezra in 458 BC, from Ezra chapter 7, verses 7, as well as verse 13. Ezra desired to restore the Jewish people to a state of faithful adherence to God's law, from Ezra chapter 7, verses 25 through 27. The third and final wave of exiles returned to Jerusalem in 444 BC, led by Nehemiah to rebuild the wall, from Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 1 through 9. Ezra was a teacher of the law of Moses, commissioned by God, from Ezra chapter 7, verse 6. Ezra was made aware that the people of Judah had committed grave sins in Ezra chapter 9. The most glaring infraction was that they had intermarried with people groups outside of Israel, according to Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 3. This prohibition was not based on any racial or ethnic enmity. Rather, God warned in Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 4, and I quote, "For they will turn your children away from following me to serve other gods, and the Lord's anger will burn against you and will quickly destroy you." Paul also warned against idolatry in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 through 15, and I quote, "Do not be yoked together with unbelievers. For what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship can light have with darkness? What harmony is there between Christ and Belial? Or what does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? Yet even as the people return from exile in Babylon for sin, the men of Judah were marrying pagan women. If these men were divorcing Jewish wives as well, the result was abuse of divorce laws and resulting hardship for the former wives." From Malachi chapter 2, verse 13 through 16, as well as from Matthew chapter 19, verse 1 through 9. So Ezra's reaction to the people disobedient serve as the subject of today's lesson. And so I want to look at one slide on the screen that deals with 1,000 years of prophets and prophetic leadership for the spring of 2021. And we're down to lesson number 6, which deals with Ezra. And Ezra's timeline for ministering was from 458 to 446 BC. This was approximately 80 years after they had been released from exile in Babylon. And so the subject of today's lesson is faith in action preacher. And so down at the bottom of the page, I want to make this note about the Jews. And let's just look at the bottom and read that together. The Jews who returned from the Babylonian captivity were under Persian rule. So there was no king in Judah in the days of Ezra, Nehemiah, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi spoke and wrote prophetic messages. In other words, they didn't have kings now because they were under the rulership of, once they had been under the rulership of the Babylonian nation for 70 years, and now they are under the rulership of the Persian nation under King Cyrus. And so this is where our lesson really picks up when Ezra is returning to Jerusalem from the Babylonian exile, and he comes there as a priest as well as a teacher of the law. And Ezra had purpose in his heart to reestablish Judah at the southern kingdom in the proper worshiping of the God Almighty. And so as we look here at our first outline, which is conviction of sin, from Ezra chapter 10, verse 1 through 4, let's just read that concerning the confession and weeping. Verse 1 reads, "While Ezra was praying and confessing, weeping and throwing himself down before the house of God, a large crowd of Israelites, men, women, and children, gathered around him. They too wept bitterly." Ezra had been made aware that the men of Judah had committed grave sins in Ezra chapter 9. And so Ezra immediately took this to heart. Ezra led by example the sincerity of Ezra distressed over Judah's sin is emphasized by the intensity of praying, confessing, weeping, and throwing himself down before the house of God. Both Ezra's body and his spirit were marked by brokenness and sorrow. The house of God refers to the temple that had been rebuilt during Zerubbabel's, who was Judah's governor during that period, during his leadership from Ezra chapter 6, verse 13 through 22. Construction of the temple was completed in about 515 BC, and the second temple stood until the Romans destroyed it in AD 70, which was about 585 years after their return from captivity. Ezra was acting on behalf of the people and for himself. His own conviction and contrition became an example for others when the large crowd of Israelite men, women, and children gathered before the Lord and wept over their sin. As Ezra led Judah in confessing their sin, he was bringing the nation to a restored relationship with God. And that's really what it takes to restore a relationship with God. One is to be convicted of your sin, to admit your sin. And the other one is to confess your sin and ask God for forgiveness. And so now Ezra has had the people do the confession, as well as they have expressed remorse and regret through their weeping and through their mourning. And so now we see that in our next outline, the covenant and courage, from verses 2 through 4. Let's just read that together. Then Shechaniah, son of Jehiel, one of the descendants of Elam, said to Ezra, "We have been unfaithful to our God by marrying foreign women from the people around us. But in spite of this, there is still hope for Israel. Now let us make a covenant before our God to send away all these women and their children, in accordance with the counsel of my Lord and of those who fear the commands of our God. Let it be done according to the law. Rise up. This matter is in your hands. We will support you, so take courage and do it." And so Shechaniah is a descendant of King David, as we read in 1 Chronicles chapter 3, verse 1, as well as verses 21 through 22. Jehiel was likely the father of Obadiah, one of the returning exiles in Ezra chapter 8, verse 9. Jehiel is included in a group of those that were guilty of this intermarriage relationship with these foreign women in Ezra chapter 10, verses 17 through 18, as well as verse 26. Now, being unfaithful here really denotes the violation of a covenant relationship or other expected behavior in the Old Testament, from 1 Chronicles chapter 5, verse 25. Marital unfaithfulness is a frequent analogy regarding Israel's relationship to their God, with Israel being the adulterous wife in Isaiah chapter 62, verse 5, as well as Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 8, and Ezekiel chapter 16, verses 22 through 38. Foreign women here were those that were not part of the covenant people. They were not part of God's chosen people, that he was in a covenant relationship with. We're talking about the Mosaic covenant that God made with them in the book of Exodus chapter 20. After he had brought them out of 40 years, after he had brought them out of Egyptian slavery for over 430 years, he made a covenant with them out there on Mount Sinai. He said, "I'll be your God if you be my people. And if you're gonna be my people, then first of all, thou shalt have no other gods before me. And then thou shalt not make any graven image or idol." And so they were in a covenant relationship with God, which they had violated, because that's why they had been placed into the Babylonian captivity. Now that they're out of Babylonian captivity, look like they're headed back down the same road. And so here, Israel had been repeatedly warned that the people around them in Canaan would lead them to an apostasy. And that is a pulling away from the one and true living God in Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 1 through 4, as well as Joshua chapter 23, verses 12 and 13. Nehemiah also would later plead with Judah to not suffer the same failures of King Solomon in Nehemiah chapter 13, verse 26 through 27. As a matter of fact, if you remember from studying about Solomon, Solomon loved foreign women, and he had many foreign women. And he, in his older age, he allowed them to have their own idols and to worship their own idols. And he even set up altars for them, I guess to appease them, to keep them happy. But ultimately, Solomon was the one that brought this idol worshiping into the southern kingdom, into Judah. And so a repentant heart is what is needed here and what would make possible hope possible in a right relation with God to be restored. Hope is grounded in the possibility of God's mercy. King David himself had learned firsthand that God is good, and what he does is good from Psalms 119, verse 68. Hope grounded in God's goodness led others to write of God's being gracious and being slow to anger and full of mercy from Psalms 103, verse 8, Psalms 145, verse 8, Joel chapter 2, verse 13, as well as Jonah chapter 4, verse 2. And so Shechaniah, who suggested this, is moving them a step forward from the sins of the past and present, as defined by Ezra in Ezra chapter 10, verse 2, as defined by Shechaniah in Ezra chapter 10, verse 2. Foreign wives could very well lead their husband back into idolatry, and as had happened to King Solomon. The threat of foreign wives posed was too great to ignore. The people had to be intent on being holy in order to please God. The extraordinary circumstances the people faced called for extraordinary action. And that extraordinary circumstances that they were in mixed marriages, they were married to heathen women, they had children, and these heathen women, it's assumed that they would continue to worship their idol gods. And so they were in an extraordinary circumstances of relieving themselves of these women and these children. And so Shechaniah acknowledged that Ezra's authority to decide and lead based on what Ezra believed was right. Obviously, Ezra was both a priest as well as a teacher of the law. So if he was a priest, that means he was a descendant of the tribe of Levi, but in particular, he was a descendant of Aaron, who was the first high priest. And so here, that reverence and awe was given to God's word as if God himself was present. God helps those who are humble and contrite in spirit, and who trembled at God's word. Isaiah points that out in Isaiah chapter 66, verse 2. And so the captivity of the exile from which Judah had returned, which had been about 80 years ago, was a vivid reminder of the danger of idolatry. Separating from their foreign wives and children probably took an overwhelming toll on these families. But the strong command, rise up, as mentioned by Shechaniah, marks the beginning of the shift from conviction to action on the part of the leaders of Judah. And so now we see in our second outline a call to appear before the assembly there in Jerusalem. And so let's just read from Ezra chapter 5, everyone promised. Verse 5, everyone promised. So Ezra rose up, and he put the leading priests and Levites and all Israel on the oath to do what had been suggested. And they took the oath. Ezra made sure that the leading priests, as well as the Levites of all Israel, were on the same page by putting them on the oath. Opposition to this task that was ahead of them had to be absolutely minimized in Ezra chapter 10. Verse 15, and there were some minor oppositions. There were some that did not want to participate. And so the leaders and lay people made a covenant before God to send away all these foreign women and their children in Ezra chapter 10, verse 3. And so now we see Ezra mourning in verse 6. And let's read verse 6 together. Then Ezra withdrew from before the house of God, and went to the room of Jehohanan, son of Eliashib. While he was there, he ate no food, and drink no water, because he continued to mourn over the unfaithfulness of the exile. Ezra withdrew to be alone in the dwelling of Johanan, son of Eliashib, who were Levites, from Nehemiah chapter 12, verse 23. All priests were Levites. As a matter of fact, all priests descended from the tribe of Levi. But not all Levites were priests, because priests also descended from the lineage of Aaron. And so Ezra was overcome with grief regarding the unfaithfulness of the returning exiles. So he fasted from food and water, which was the result of his pain in his spirit. In other words, Ezra's spirit was still painfully sorrowful because of what had happened to these returning exiles so soon after they had been released from captivity in Babylon. It had just been 80 years, and looks like they are headed down that same road again. Ezra carried a sense of loss as he reflected on years his people wasted as they chased false gods and denied the Lord. And so we see here that Ezra makes a proclamation in verses 7 through 8. And let's just read that. A proclamation was then issued throughout Judah and Jerusalem for all the exiles to assemble in Jerusalem. Anyone who failed to appear within 3 days would forfeit all his property in accordance with the decision of the official and elders, and would himself be expelled from the assembly of the exile. Ezra gave special charge or proclamation to the leading priests and Levites to spread the news of the need to assemble in Jerusalem in 3 days. Priests and Levites live among all the tribes. As Joshua divided the land, he did not really give priests land, but he gave them townships, and he gave them areas that they could live in. We see that in Joshua chapter 14, verse 1 through 4. And so priests and Levites were scattered among all the tribes. And so forfeiting one land and possession and being cut off from the assembly was not for not attending the assembly would be the same treatment that the foreign wife would experience. This was a serious undertaking. And this was in order for them to be restored into a right relationship with God. They were going to have to follow through on their conviction. And so here, those penalized for not attending the assembly would have to find their homes elsewhere, away from God's people. In other words, they would be cut off from their inheritance. And so now we see in our third outline in Ezra chapter 10, verse 9 through 12, a call to action. We see the fearful people gathering together within the 3 days here. And so let's just read verse 9. Verse 9 says, within the 3 days, all the men of Judah and Benjamin had gathered in Jerusalem. And on the 20th day of the ninth month, all the people were sitting in the square before the house of God, greatly distressed by the occasion and because of the rain. Only the tribes of Judah and Benjamin, having returned from exile in Babylon, remained to answer the call to assemble in Jerusalem. The other 10 tribes of Israel had been removed to exile in Assyria more than 180 years previously in 722 BC from 2 Kings chapter 17, verse 6. The 20th day of the month corresponds to early December, which was the rainy season. And so the people were greatly spiritually and physically distressed by the occasion and because of the rain. The occasion was being the assembly to make some tough decisions about putting away those foreign wives and children they had. That was a tough decision. But they had violated the laws of Moses. In other words, and the assumption was that these foreign wives, like they had done with Solomon, would lead these people away from worshiping the true God and to worshiping idol gods. And so here, the people were greatly spiritually and physically distressed because of that occasion, as well as because they sat there in the square in the cold rain. All the people were sitting in the square outside before the house of God, which was the temple that had been reconstructed by Zerubbabel when he was among the first of the exiles to return from Babylon back into Jerusalem. And so we see Ezra here as a fearless preacher in verses 10 through 11. Then Ezra, the priest, stood up and said to them, "You have been unfaithful. You have married foreign women, adding to Israel's guilt. Now honor the Lord, the God of your ancestors, and do his will. Separate yourselves from the people around you and from your foreign wives. Ezra was both a priest as well as a teacher of the law of God in Ezra chapter 7, verse 11 and verse 21, as well in Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 9, and Nehemiah chapter 12, verse 26. All those scriptures acknowledge the fact that Ezra was a learned priest and a learned teacher of the law. And he also here is a prophet because he's speaking what thus said the Lord. Ezra's statement that they were adding to Israel's guilt implies that the people hadn't learned the lesson of the exile in Babylon. Instead of working to decrease the sin, they were working to add to their sins from 2 Chronicles chapter 28, verse 13, by reverting back to what had sent them into captivity in the first place, and that was wholesale idolatry. Through marrying these foreign women, they were subjecting themselves to being led into idolatry again. And so Ezra restated the charge against Judah, that you have been unfaithful, you have married foreign women, in Ezra chapter 2, verse 2a. To the whole assembly now he speaks this. Ezra now lays out the necessary steps toward reconciliation and restoration with God. First, they had to honor the Lord by admitting or confessing their wrongdoing. And that's what God, John tells us in 1 John chapter 1 verse 9, if we confess our sins, that he is faithful and just enough unto forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And then after honoring the Lord by being convicted and admitting their sins, they were to do God's will, and which was what he had commanded in the first place in the book of Deuteronomy. What he had desired all along, that they would not serve and follow after those idol gods, and that they would not, you know, take unto themselves heathen wives, or nor give their sons to heathen daughters. And so the people were required to separate yourselves from the people around them and from their foreign wives. Only by serving their influences could the men of Judah and Benjamin be certain that the wives wouldn't tempt and lead them into idolatry. And so finally in verse 12, we see a faithful practice outlined in verse 12. And so let's read verse 12 as Ezra has outlined what they need to do in verses 10 and 11. Now we see how the assembly respond, and the only way they should respond. The whole assembly responded with a loud voice. You are right. We must do as you say. The whole assembly responded with a loud voice of a unified people who experienced conviction of their sins. And so after being convicted, Ezra told the leadership that they need to help foster that commitment now. And that the Ezra leadership had been significant or instrumental in help fostering the commitment now that the people had made and the conviction that they had made and how they had responded to Ezra's charge. And so the spiritual leaders worth following, any spiritual leader really like Ezra worth following, will always direct people to God and to his glory only. And that's something we need to consider. We need to make sure that if we're following somebody, we make sure that that person is pointing us to God and to bring God glory. And so let's look at the conclusion for our lesson today. as we read content with mere conviction. We see episode after episode of Israel's rebellion against God and God's subsequent restoration of his covenant people. The people of God were in danger of sliding back again into idolatry because of their disobedience to God's law. God's law are put in place for our good and for his glory. We too are tempted by the culture that surrounds us, including the temptation to marry unbelievers. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14 through 15, Paul warns against idolatry, and I quote from verse 14 and 15. Do not be yoked together with unbelievers. For what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship can light have with darkness? What harmony is there between Christ and Belial? Or what does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? God's mercy provides hope for Israel to be restored to a right relationship with him. But that required someone who would take the lead. It all begins with having a burden of the heart and soul like Ezra. God's forgiving grace is available to us because of the person and work of Jesus Christ. The church is Jesus' bride from 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 2, Revelations chapter 19, verses 7 through 9, Revelations chapter 21, verse 2 and 9, and Revelations chapter 22, verse 17. May we be faithful to our bridegroom. Our thought to remember or takeaway for today is action is the hallmark of true conviction. And so we see from James chapter 2, verse 24, these words. You see that a person is considered righteous by what they do and not by faith alone. James chapter 2, verse 24. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for this day and for the study of your holy word. We thank you, Father, for the Old Testament. As we look in the book of Ezra, Father, and we see Ezra as being a prophet, a priest, as well as a teacher of the law of God, a faith in action type preacher, Father, one who believed that if we are convicted by our faith, Father, then we must act on that conviction. Help us to be more and more convinced, Father, of our faithfulness toward you. And whatever, Father, we have to do to stand boldly for your name and for your word, give us the conviction to act on that faith. Thank you for your darling son, Jesus, who because of his death and his burial and his resurrection, and his commitment, Father, that he has made in going to the cross to give his life as a ransom for many. Help us to, by faith, hold on to our belief in Jesus and to be restored into a right relationship with you through faith in Jesus. In his precious name we pray. Amen. Thank you for joining us, and may God bless you and keep you and your family is my prayer.
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. What was lost in battle? What was taken? Unlawful, where the enemy has planted his seed, and where health is ailing, and where strength is failing, I will restore to you all of this and more. I will restore to you all of this and more. I will restore. I will restore. I will restore to you